News Epicenter with me, Maria Shakil. India's GDP for COVID hit 2020-2021 contracted by 7.3%, even as GDP for the year's last quarter grew by 1.6%. This contraction is marginally better than the forecasts of the Reserve Bank of India and the Centre. Both had expected GDP for the full year to contract by 8%. Most of the damage to the economy was done in the April-March quarter, when GDP had contracted by an unprecedented 24.4% due to the nationwide lockdown. Once again, the primary driver was the agriculture sector, as manufacturing, construction and services showed marginal improvement quarter on quarter. The issues that persist continue to be rising fuel prices, inflation and unemployment, while there is no clarity if there will be a stimulus to reboot the economy. However, the finance minister has made it clear that the budget is primed to tackle COVID challenges and the impact will be seen soon. So, to decode the road to recovery, I am being joined by the Chief Economic Advisor to the Government of India, K.V. Subramaniam. Dr. Subramaniam, appreciate your time here. Indian economy contracted 7.3% in financial year 2021. It was worst in 40 years, yet not as bad as many economists and market had feared. Annual economic growth rate picked up in January-March at 1.6% compared with the previous 3 months. Would you say that the GDP reading was along expected lines?
Thank you very much, Maria, for inviting me and a very good evening to viewers. If you would recall, at the end of the first quarter of last year, after the GDP print had come at 24.5% decline, I had mentioned that there would be a recovery, a V-shaped recovery, with the second quarter being much better performance than the first quarter, and positive growth in the third and the fourth quarter. And that is indeed what has transpired with the I would mention that we should be looking at the change in gross value added for the third and fourth quarters, because GDP is your GVA plus taxes minus subsidies. And subsidies have been exceptionally high, both because of the pandemic year and the subsidies that have had to be given, plus the change in the accounting norms that was announced in the budget, all the off-balance sheet items being brought on balance sheet. So together with that, if you look at third quarter, the gross value added change was about 1.6% and 3.7% in Q4. So these are all actually good signs. Of course, and I'll mention that the second wave has robbed some of the momentum. But before that, I must highlight a couple of important things. If you look at consumption, it grew at 2.7% for the first time in three quarters. More importantly, investment grew significantly at about, gross fixed capital formation has hit 34% of GDP, which is the highest in 26 quarters. And especially construction activity grew at 15%. And construction activity especially is quite important for the urban poor, because informal sector jobs are created. And finally, industry itself grew at over 8%. And services, especially some of the contact intensive services, where the decline was only 2.3%, after having recorded close to double-digit declines in previous quarters, which actually suggests that the fear of the pandemic, which was not as high in the month of, in the fourth quarter, led to the economic recovery. Going forward, with the second wave now, declining, and especially the decline being as sharp as was the rise, I am anticipating that economic activity should be back, quickly with restrictions being eased. So next quarter onwards, I think we should be able to get back to better economic activities. And I think the vaccination program, which is now being pushed and accelerated significantly, will play a critical role in this.
Dr. Subramaniam, unlike the first wave, the economy was not totally closed during the second wave. There were lesser restrictions as well. Many factories were operating, so was construction and other economic activities. Consumption too wasn't down given better logistics and home delivery mechanism. Do you feel not closing the economy will help the economy remain afloat during the current quarter?
Yeah, I think you're quite right. The important distinction between the second wave and the first wave was that the restrictions have now been more localized, as a result of which they are asynchronous and heterogeneous as well in their timing. And what that ensures, therefore, is that there isn't a systemic nationwide impact. Interstate activity, for instance, has been going on. A lot of the essential activities are still happening. For instance, if you look at the infrastructure, the core infrastructure production in the month of April, despite lockdowns or restrictions in some of the states, it's grown at 56% compared to the last year, albeit, of course, a lower base. But still, the growth itself is actually indicative. The other thing I will mention, despite the decline in the mobility indicators, the Google mobility indicators in the month of April and May, less in April, more in May. But what we are noticing is that in the last 10 days, all these high frequency indicators are starting to trend up. For instance, e-way bills and power consumption both have started, they've hit the trough and have actually started moving up. The other thing is, while the purchasing managers indices have gone down, for manufacturing and services, they still continue to be in expansionary zone, for instance, for the manufacturing one. So the economy actually and people in the market, while they have taken into account that the second wave has had some impact for sure, and I've mentioned this in my press conference too, the impact is not likely to be very large. Of course, there will be some impact, but not likely to be very large.
There is a demand for economic stimulus from various sectors of the economy. Sectors like hospitality, travel, automobiles, entertainment as well have been badly hit. The finance minister in a recent interview said that the budget had been presented keeping that in mind. In fact, they had kept the impact of COVID and various stimulus provided under the Atmanirbhar Bharat package had still not been utilized. How do you think we can address these two competing views, and could we expect a more customized economic relief targeted at specific sectors, particularly hospitality and tourism?
So, Maria, first thing I would mention is that the budget itself was a significantly expansionary one on the fiscal side and was especially counter-cyclical in terms of the fiscal response. For instance, a 9.5% fiscal deficit number for the year that went by and a 6.5% fiscal deficit for this year. And that spending being focused especially on infrastructure and thereby fostering construction activity. Here I return back to what I mentioned earlier. If you remember, I mentioned that these contact intensive sectors had registered a decline of only 2.3% in the month of March after having had almost double digit declines in the previous quarters. And I'm bringing this up because construction activity in the fourth quarter grew at 15%. So when construction grew, the contact sensitive sectors also actually were less, the demand for those grew as well. So I think this is a key point that we have to remember, that the budget, the philosophy of which was widely supported by one and all, across the board. I think that philosophy continues to remain, and it's only 2 months and there have been restrictions. So a lot of in construction activity, especially infrastructure spending by the FISC, will start manifesting in the this month and the coming months, which will foster construction activity and thereby also help these sectors. That said, I do want to mention that like in over the last year, we continue to be receptive to feedback and assessments on the ground level situation, and will respond. It's only 2 months right now into the, and I think the impact of the fiscally expansionary budget will indeed be felt as has been felt in the fourth quarter.
Okay, just look at some statistics. Over 10 million Indians have lost their jobs because of the second wave of COVID-19, and around 97% of household incomes have declined since the beginning of the pandemic last year. These are staggeringly high data, which is a huge matter of concern, certainly.
Maria, I presume you are using the CMI employment numbers to quote this. I have been mentioning this, and there was a very nice article written in the Economic Times by a senior official in the Ministry of Finance that works in my team, where they really called into question the methodology that is adopted. The survey methodology is not very sound, and so the numbers that come actually do not correlate well. They do not pass the smell test, for instance. A simple thing that you expect is that when the economy is doing well, employment numbers should be higher, and that is not the case, unlike the government's the periodic labor force survey. So because there is actually a problem both on the methodology and on the output that comes out of that, the employment numbers, I would actually go by the government responses. That having said, I do definitely acknowledge that there will be an impact on the on the employment numbers, and the MNREGA demand, for instance, was increased significantly last year. The same we are ready to do that as well. Okay. Incidentally, I'll mention, if you look at the MNREGA demand for the month of May and compare it to the month of May last year, what you see is that the demand for work has been much lower in May of this year compared to May of last year. So distressed work in the rural areas, distressed demand for work has not been as high as the last year. But that said, I think, apart from the impact of the expansionary budget itself being fed through the economy in the coming months, we remain ready to respond, further as well.
Yes, you mentioned MNREGA. MNREGA is in rural India. What about urban joblessness? India's urban unemployment rate has soared to almost 18%.
So that's why I was mentioning the construction activity and the focus on infrastructure. The reason that we have focused so much on construction activity, Maria, is that data on the urban poor, for instance, often a lot of these are migrant labor, and it's the actual data on them is not as easily available. Therefore, while MNREGA can be targeted, because that is typically where the person resides, the person looks for work as well there, that's not the case though with urban poor, a lot of whom are migrant labor. Therefore, the emphasis has to be on informal sector jobs, which the construction activity provides in huge numbers. As I was mentioning again earlier as well, the 15% increase in Q4 actually did have an impact on some of the consumption as well. So going forward too, as the government steps up and the implements what has been planned in the budget, once the restrictions come down, I think that will create jobs significantly in the informal sector for the urban poor.
Okay.
And that is something that is quite important for their well-being.
So, Dr. Subramaniam, is the government looking at a more transformative policy intervention going forward to really rev up India's economy in the next 2 to 3 years? And God forbid if a third wave hits the country in the short run. What are the preparations, if I may specifically ask, that have been put in place?
I would like to remind our viewers that if you look at the last 1 year, the slew of reforms that have been launched are indeed transformative. I don't find a single country that has actually embarked on the kind of reforms that we have embarked on, including the privatization program, the fact that government basically will get out of business in most sectors except a couple of strategic ones, including the labor reform, the agricultural reform, the opening up of several sectors. So these are indeed transformative. I think let's make sure to acknowledge that, and especially the emphasis on private sector, and enabling and empowering the private sector is indeed transformative in the Indian context. Because remember, we've had been a socialist economy, and even market-oriented reforms that had been done earlier have mostly been done by stealth. In contrast, this is, you know, bold reform enabling the private sector. So we've done a lot, and we continue to actually be reformist, and we'll do all the more that is required going forward too.
Last question to you, Dr. Subramaniam. Petrol at 100 rupees, the fuel prices have really skyrocketed, and so have the inflation rate. What is the government doing to tackle these two issues?
So, from the inflation perspective, Maria, if you looked at over the last 1 year, CPI inflation, which is what the common person really faces, has been driven a lot more by food inflation, which itself was because of a lot of the supply side disruptions. In contrast, the contribution of other areas actually has not been as much as food inflation. So from an inflation perspective, I actually particularly track food inflation because that is impacted significantly by supply side factors. You have to keep in mind that that policy making involves trade-offs, and the significant expansion, fiscal expansion that we've done also means that we have to actually keep in mind some of the other balancing aspects. That said, we are actually looking at this as well to see if there's a middle ground that we can strike.
All right. Dr. Subramaniam, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for joining me on News Epicenter. Let me bring in my guests now. Zafar Islam, Member of Parliament of the BJP, Gurdeep Sappal, representing the Congress. Gurdeep, India's GDP contraction is not an isolated development. Major economies of the world, including France, Germany, UK, USA, have seen similar contraction, which was not seen for several decades. Of course, this is, as it is said, that this is once-in-a-lifetime pandemic. And given the pandemic, India experienced its largest contraction in first quarter of 2021, but came back strongly with 1.6% growth in financial year 2021. Given the scenario, why is the former finance minister calling the government inept?
Maria, let us not see the GDP figures in isolation. After demonetization, what have been the figures? It was 8%, next year 6.8%, then 3%, then 4%, and now minus because of the COVID. So COVID has only added to the woes. It is not that it is in isolation that because of COVID it has gone down. Hmm. It has been on a downward slide ever since demonetization, excuse me. Second thing, we have reported 1.41 lakh GST collection figures. That's what government is saying. And for 8 months, they say that we have been collecting more than 1 lakh. Yet, this month, they are raising 1.58 lakh crore to pay the states. They are raising it from the market. They have already got 99,000 crore from RBI. Still, they need money. So where is the money? Government keeps on saying. And why is it happening? We have to understand it. Demonetization and GST are the two issues that have led, and then COVID management. When demonetization was done in this country, the total money in circulation in the country was 17.97 lakh crore. And the purpose of demonetization was to remove the cash from market and go to a cashless economy. And after 4 years, we have 60% more cash in the country. From 17.97 lakh crore, it is 28.3 lakh crore. Whatever this government says, whatever this government does, it's only in headlines. Okay. It is not managing the economy.
Okay,
that is why we are worried.
Okay, so Zafar Islam, you are being accused of gross mismanagement as far as the economy is concerned. And the Congress feels that it has nothing to do with COVID per se. The mismanagement began with demonetization.
Well, Maria, let me respond to him. First of all, I think he should read the reports which is being not published by Bharatiya Janata Party or the Government of India, but the report which is being published by the World Bank, International Monetary Fund, or for that matter, Asian Development Bank, and many other financial institutions and global institutions, and their report they must read. I think Congress spokesperson must read, and they will get to know what exactly how the economy is being managed by the country, and it is being appreciated by everyone, including the rating agencies, that the way it has been managed, and globally everyone is comfortable and confident about the management of India, the way it is being managed. That's why the stock market is the reflection of the financial health of the country and people's confidence in the country and its economy. So let me tell you first, he is still talking about the demonetization. There are many structural reforms which have been undertaken by the government. One of them was GST and demonetization. And it has advantages, many advantages. In one stroke of pen, Government of India could achieve many things which otherwise was not possible. So they may sing a tune which is not in line with the global
community. So you are being accused of your political criticism.
You have given him enough time and let me also have some time to speak also. So all I'm saying that in India, as you rightly pointed out, Maria, that Indian economy and the GDP contraction cannot be seen in isolation. There are many economies in the world which has seen contraction. And when he's talking about prior to COVID or the lockdown, Indian economy has shown some kind of contraction. Yes, it did. But you have to also see the global how the global economy has contracted during that time. From 3.92, it has come down to 2.85% global GDP. That kind of contraction we had seen. And India, it does not work in isolation. It's an integrated economy and it's part of the global economy. So when there is a contraction globally, it has to have this kind of impact in local economy as well.
Gurdeep, India's GST collection at 1.44 lakh crore in the month of April has been the highest ever. There has been growth in passenger vehicle sales, two-wheeler sales, steel and cement production. The index of 8 core industries grew at 11.4% in March and 56.1% in April. Then what really is, concern of the Congress party with the economy, Gurdeep?
I request Mr. Sappal to see all the high frequency data of March, April and even PMI data of May. That it is an expansionary mode because it is above 50. It is not contracting.
I'll respond to you, Zafar. You see, Maria, after class 10th, economy, commerce and accounts are three different subjects. Unfortunately for this government, all three are same. They confuse economy for accounting and accounting for commerce. I'll tell you how. Right now, India was the fastest, best performing economy up to 2016. Even if other economies of the world have contracted, rightly so, because of COVID, still, we should have been one of the best performing economies. Now we are among the worst. So we have fared much, much worse than other economies who also have contracted because of COVID. So our woes are not just limited to COVID. Whatever this government did in last 4-5 years, it has not performed. Do you remember Make in India? What was the target? 2022, we will have 25% of manufacturing sector contribution to GDP. That time it was almost 16%. It has come down to 13.5. They have failed. Do you remember exports?
Exports
used to be 25% of the GDP. Now it is 13%. So you don't pick up one sector or one data on negative growth. Okay. Negative growth of 7.3% means that it has to rebound back. And it will, even if it rebounds back by 8-9%, the total growth is 1-2%.
Zafar.
It's a simple mathematics.
Yes.
It's simple mathematics.
Okay, Zafar. You know, which sectors of the economy are you hopeful will lead the recovery process? Because many sectors like travel, tourism, automobile, which contribute majorly to the GDP, would take time to normalize.
Well, Maria, you have to really see in second lockdown, when the states are announcing the lockdown, you have to also see that the economic activities have not been put to rest. In fact, if somebody has to really see, you have to see Oxford index and stringency index. And I think that will show you exactly how the economy is functioning. So when it was last year, the index suggesting it was 100% means there was absolutely no economic activity. Right now it is 54. That suggests that a lot of economic activities, despite the lockdown.
But Zafar, so the fact is that there has been mismanagement also on the vaccination policy, and that is the reason why the slower than needed vaccination drive can prove detrimental to the recovery and economic health of the country.
What made you say that the mismanagement of vaccination drive?
Well, the Supreme Court has asked some questions to you directly this time.
No, they have asked just to the policy they have asked. But let me respond to you. You have, India is not only one nation in the globe. There are many nations in the globe. And just see the in terms of performance, 20% of the world population lives in this great country. And in terms of absolute number and the percentage of the population, India is ahead of every single country barring the USA and China. So what is you holding you making this kind of statement that India is mismanaging vaccination drive? Secondly, I think you have to also understand that the retail sector and the particularly the sectors which you have just mentioned, this hospitality, the tourism, the restaurant, the hotel, these are the sectors which is not doing well because this, you need customer interaction, and that is where the lockdown is being imposed. So once the lockdown is over, the momentum is there, the government of India will also introduce some of the measures
this discussion. Gurdeep and Zafar, thank you so much for joining us. This entire debate on news18.com. That's all from me. Thanks so much for watching.